640 Sports.
WTVN,
Beltran turns and looks. Nick Franklin is headed out, and the Rays take a 4-3 lead.
You look at later in the game, Rumbelow there in that situation. What was he trying to do? What happened?
Well, he left a changeup up in the zone. You know, he's trying to get it down, and he'd done a good job on Longoria and getting it down, and he just didn't get it down. And turned into a home run.
Swing and he popped him up. This'll do it. Left field, Mikey Montok over to his left. He is under it waiting, and the Rays have defeated the Yankees.
So not a ton of offense tonight. Why do you think they had a tough time getting things going?
Well, I mean, he's been pretty tough on us. When we've got to him, we've hit home runs, and that's kind of what we did tonight. We just didn't have a lot of hits. I thought he elevated his fastball well tonight and used his split, you know, his other pitches pretty well.
Hammered to right center, going back, Granderson at the wall, looking up, and it is up, up and away. A line drive home run into the Marlins bullpen by D. Gordon. And the Marlins get two runs back just like that and lead 9-3 here in the ninth inning.
The 0-2 pitch. Swing and a drive. Well hit to center, but playable for Ozuna. Backing up, he makes the catch. The ball game is over, and so is the Mets' 8-game winning streak. The final score, the Miami Marlins 9 and the New York Mets 3.
Terry, for Jake tonight, was it command again?
That'd be my guess. I mean, I haven't been just standing on the side where I was at. I got a pretty bad angle, but there were some pretty good swings, which indicate to me they were not, the balls were not in the right place. And, you know, again, Dan talked about, we've got to make sure that we get the ball down the zone, and that's where, you know, he's been struggling lately. He's left a lot of balls up and been hurt.
At this point, how much do you feel he could use a blow here?
Well, you know, we're sitting there tonight in the dugout afterwards talking about, you know, his pitch count wasn't bad. It wasn't great, but it wasn't bad. But, you know, he doesn't pitch for another 6 days. He got at least six full days off, and we'll see where we are. But, you know, the one thing we cannot forget is we are in a pennant race. We are at the end of the season. We do not need to be getting rid of our best pitchers and letting them sit on the side for a while. So we need to give him, you know, a few days to let him rest up a little bit and then get him ready for whatever happens. If we decide to skip him, we skip him. But, you know, we got some games in between. We'll see what goes on.
I'm joined right now by the great host of Real Time on HBO with Bill Maher. Bill, it's great not to be employed by anybody, isn't it? I mean, is that the case? It's like Ann Coulter. If you don't work for anybody, nobody can fire you. You say what you want. Is that the Trump secret?
Well, that's the best part of him. You know, that thing, the quote you just read there, talking about how he never has to apologize and never does apologize, I do find that attractive because I've been in that position myself many times. I mean, I don't agree with much of what Donald Trump says, but sometimes when I see him, I think he and I are a little like the detective and the serial killer when the serial killer says, you know, we're not so different, you and I. And the great thing about having your own money is that you don't have to appeal to the donors. The one good thing Donald Trump is saying is that he's going to raise his own taxes and he's going to go after hedge fund managers and stuff like that. That's actually popular even with Republicans. It's the donor class that hates that. That's why you won't hear that from the other guys.
I want to get to the man right now who was moderating the CNN debate right here in Simi Valley, CNN's chief Washington correspondent, the anchor of the lead, State of the Union, Jake Tapper, who has been shut behind closed doors preparing for this momentous occasion.
We have been involved in intense debate preparation, going over questions, trying to figure out the best way to phrase them to make sure that everyone gets a fair amount of questions, that we really prompt debate as much as possible, that it's not just a series of 11 interview questions, that it's, or 15 as the case may be if you include the undercard debate, that it's not a forum where they all can extrapolate and give their talking points. We want debate about policy, about politics, about leadership, about the different things they bring, the different things they have said about each other. So we've been very, very hard at work, me and the team here, who are incredible.
You have asked four questions from everyone on Twitter. You have a sense of what most people want to hear?
No, because we've actually heard from literally tens of thousands of people, and their questions as varied as one from a very passionate woman who feels very strongly the candidate should be doing more to make sure that people at football games, when they get an evacuation notice on their cell phones, should not believe it. And she's really against the potential stampeding that could happen. This is a woman who's very active on that. Then there's questions about NATO, questions about abortion, questions about government shutdowns, jobs. I mean, everything. The sky's the limit. We're not going to be able to get to all the questions, but we're going to try to really have as many as possible on a varied amount of topics.
The same 10 candidates we saw last time around will be on stage, with the addition of Carly Fiorina, who was in the earlier so-called happy hour debate, who's now jumped up to the bigger group. What are they going to have to work with in this contest? They can't bring any phones with them, no tablets, no notes, no props. Each candidate will have a pad of paper and a pen and a glass of water. And what will they be facing? Well, our panel will be comprised of our moderator, Jake Tapper, also CNN's Dana Bash, and Hugh Hewitt from radio. They will be posing questions, along with some questions that will be taken from social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and so forth. The subject matters are going to be foreign policy, domestic policy, and politics. Big, broad topics, and with so many people on stage, they will have narrow windows in which to answer. 1 minute per answer, 30 seconds if it's a rebuttal to something else that was said about you, and we will use tiny lights to show the candidates if they are running out of time. And lest you think the people who are in the earlier debate are at a huge disadvantage, yes, they may very well have a smaller audience, but they'll also have a whole lot more time to express their ideas. And under the rules, if one of them says something that is particularly sharp or interesting, that video clip can be played in the larger debate, and those candidates will have to answer to it.
I'm rolling thunder, power and rain. I'm coming down like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, won't spare no lives. Nobody's putting up a fight.
Night coming up. Thank you, AC/DC, Hell's Bells, to get you going. Dark and early, 6:07 a.m. on this Wednesday morning. Huge night coming up, not because it's the Mets and the Marlins, which I guess it is, or the Yankees and the Rays, which I guess it is. There's no football tonight. It is debate night, debate number two for the GOP. And the first one I thought was okay. We talked an awful lot about that. Actually, the first one, the days prior to the debate, that Tuesday and Wednesday, that first debate was a Thursday night, I believe. On that Tuesday and Wednesday, I was hosting the midday show at WABC in New York alongside Bernard McGuirk, filling in for Geraldo Rivera. So I distinctly remember that first debate. We had a lot of discussion up in New York about that. Peter King stopped by in studio. Chuck Todd from Meet the Press came on with me and Bernard, and we handled that debate that way. On this one, we're here, and it is tonight, the second of, I believe, 12 Republican debates. There were only six, compared to 26, by the way, last time, only six Democrat debates, and the first one coming up in Las Vegas next month. But number two, and you heard there from a bunch of different folks, a little back-and-forth conversation from MSNBC between Chris Matthews and Bill Maher, who's a complete asshole, but he does well, and I do watch his HBO show every now and then, and you heard some of that, and somebody on CNN interviewing Jake Tapper. Of course, this is a CNN debate tonight. The first one we know was Fox, and they got a lot of play, didn't they? Megyn Kelly and and Brett and Chris Wallace as well. Tonight it will be Jake Tapper, radio host Hugh Hewitt, and a bunch of other guys. I don't know who else. I guess the chick was on with us yesterday. Allison Camerati is going to be in the green room. Yeah,
Dana Bash will also be
Dana Bash.
Sitting.
There you go.
Those three.
That was all we had. Who was the last guy in the open talking about the debate? Was that a CNN guy as well?
That was our guy. That was one of their strategists. One of the strategists. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. I don't recall his name.
Not Wolfie.
No.
Not from the Situation Room.
No. It was not.
Of course, you got the kitty table. You can say titty. That's fine. The kitty table coming up at 6 o'clock tonight. Now, I believe in the first debate, there were as many as 8 or 9. Maybe I'm wrong, because I know that Carly Fiorina was at the kiddie table. She's at the big table tonight. Rick Perry was at the kiddie table. He has since exited the race. That guy from Virginia was at the kiddie table. He's also gone.
There were seven.
Okay, now there's four. Those are the three that are no longer there tonight. George Pataki, the former governor of New York, he'll be at the kiddie table tonight. Rick Santorum, who came in second in the GOP last time around out of Pennsylvania, he's at the kiddie table tonight. Louisiana's Bobby Jindal at the kiddie table tonight. And our very good friend Lindsey Graham, who's been on this show twice, he is at the kiddie table tonight. And then, of course, we've got the 11 big guns coming up at 8 o'clock, 2 hours later on CNN. That includes Donald Trump, Carly Fiorina, Ben Carson, Jeb Bush, Scott Walker, Chris Christie, Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, Mike Huckabee, Marco Rubio, and John Kasich. 11 folks, 10 men, 1 woman at the big table later on tonight. And Chris West is here today once again for his second straight day, third day overall, filling in for the vacationing Eric Lengel, still on his honeymoon in Disney. Yeah, some go to Paris, some go to Rome. I'm going to Disney. But that, of course, that's what he can afford, so that's fine. And he looked great. I saw the pictures.
Yeah, he actually did.
He looked great. And Alicia's a really pretty girl, so she looked beautiful.
I was pleasantly surprised. Yeah. Eric looked good with the tux, and he looked professional.
Yeah.
I figured it would be... I look good.
Yeah, I thought he'd wear like a cutoff sleeveless shirt
exactly,
or something, and he looked great. But Chris West is here, and Chris West, believe it or not, when you look at him, you wouldn't know this, but he's very politically astute. What do you think about tonight's debate?
I'm just interested to see, like Tapper said, they're going to schedule the questions to where it'll breed debates within the candidates, and of course, you got your wild card, Donald Trump. See what he's going to say, what left card.
Let me ask you an honest question. You're on this show, so you've got no choice but to discuss what I want you to discuss. That's how it works. But if you're not on this show, would you have any interest? Because I know the truth is no, because I know you're excited tonight about the debut of, not the debut, the new season of South Park or something.
Yes, I'm more interested in tonight's episode of South Park and Saturday's premiere of Doctor Who than I am of the debate.
What is Saturday premiere? What?
The season 9 of Doctor Who.
Doctor Who.
Yes, Peter Capaldi as the Doctor.
I know it. And South Park, is it a new season that starts tonight?
Yeah, new season of South Park tonight.
What time is that on?
Well, it'll be 10 o'clock Wednesday night, as it's been for the last almost 20 years now.
It's got to be well over. South Park, I didn't think they were still making new episodes.
I mean, the good news for you is you can watch the debate for 2 hours from 8 to 10. Now, it's a three-hour debate tonight because there's 11 people, but you can do 2 hours of the debate and then blow off the last hour and catch South Park.
There you go.
That's exciting.
And they'll be taking on Caitlyn Jenner and the Caitlyn Jenner controversy. Oh,
that'll be funny. Make sure you get that audio for tomorrow, actually.
All right. Yeah. I will try to get something for you.
Well, it's nice to have you back. Chris West is here, and Z-Mac is here, and you are into all this stuff. I know you're a Met fan, so obviously we had the Yankee highlights or lowlights. That's a tough loss to the Rays last night. Good news for the Yanks is Toronto lost, so the Yankees remain 3 back of the Blue Jays inside the American League East. The Mets got rolled by Miami. Washington did win last night, so the Nationals pick up a game, but the Mets still have a very comfortable 8.5-game lead. Not really worried about Washington, more worried about Jacob deGrom, who I think most Met fans would agree distinguished himself over the last year and a half as the best pitcher on the Mets, even better than Matt Harvey, but he has not been very good, and you start to wonder, young guy, lots of innings, what he's got left for the postseason. Before we get to that, the debate tonight, how excited are you?
I'm pumped. I'm even pumped for the 6 o'clock one.
So am I. There's only four people,
which I like that.
That should be a good debate.
Yeah, and like we heard in the open, if content comes up that they think is worth playing at the 8 o'clock debate, they'll play it.
They'll
so
play
there's
it,
a chance that someone from 6 o'clock could at least jump in the 8 o'clock debate, at least with some audio recording, you know, blah, 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 said this at 6.
Well, what do you think? They did that last time. You know, last time, of course, Carly Fiorina was so good that she moved from the kiddie table to the adult table. Do you think any one of these four men, again, Governor Pataki out of New York, Bobby Jindal out of Louisiana, Rick Santorum out of Pennsylvania, and Lindsey Graham out of South Carolina, any one of those four you think have a legitimate real... Now, don't forget, Santorum came in second last time. Can you see any one of those four guys being considered seriously to be at the big table for the third debate?
Maybe, and I only say this because Lindsey Graham's foreign policy, he's so struck on that. But
he's 0%.
I know. Well, don't all four? Well, one of them has 1%, I think.
I think one has 1%.
No, but I think the highest at the kiddie table is 1%, which is kind of sad. But, I mean, when you got 16 running, I guess it's going to come to some of that, and Trump's taking a quarter of it by himself.
It.
So 75% split between 14
I believe the and 15. Next, I believe the next GOP debate is about a month and a half away. I think it's October 28th, which is a month and 13 days in Boulder, Colorado, and that one will be a CNBC event. We've had Fox tonight as CNN. I think CNBC has it October 28th, Boulder, Colorado, debate number 3. So I'm with you. I don't think any of those four have a real shot, and what are you looking forward to tonight? Trump v. Arena going head-to-head? That's going to come up.
100% that's coming up,
Jake Tapper said yesterday, we've got that audio too, that what he enjoyed from the first debate most, and I think most of us would agree, was the back-and-forth, the legitimate debate back-and-forth between Chris Christie and Rand Paul. I would hope we'll get that tonight from Donald Trump and Carly Fiorina.
We need more of that, even from others also, but we need more of that exact Christie, you know, just ramming it right down, you know, basically saying F you to Rand Paul, basically.
Right. More
we need
that.
More of that.
You want
we
more
need
that?
More real debate.
Yeah.
Just up there, you know.
What about Jeb Bush and Scott Walker? How about some? What about Ted Cruz and Rand Paul? How about some of that?
Yeah, I think so. I think Jeb is going to be, again, underwhelming.
So
and, I think Scott Walker will, too.
I hope John Kasich has a good night. I kind of like that guy. But I have no idea if he will or he won't, but I hope he does. We got a great guest list today, too. But tell me about the Mets. Are you concerned about Jacob DeGrom?
I am a little bit. And it was a home start. His ERA before last night was, I think, 1.71 at home.
Yeah.
And, that's
not
to the
good.
Marlins. To the Marlins.
Yeah.
6 runs in 6 innings.
Yeah. And that's the second time. Is it in a row? Second time this month he had a start where he gave up at least 6 earned runs.
Right. I mean, and then he was in line for the loss a couple weeks ago where
that's
he gave up 3 earned runs and
that's
Cespedes hit the homer and they went ahead. So
he
I
bailed
mean,
him out.
Right. But, a little concerning the last 5 or 6 starts.
I sent a tweet yesterday to my dear friend, our dear friend from ESPN, Jason Stark, one of the best baseball writers in the country. Because here I was having lunch yesterday at Stallone's, the great Stallone's restaurant in West Boca, Bobby and Michelle Stallone, getting ready for my workout with Katie, watching TV, and they had MLB.com on. And I'm watching it, not really watching it, but it's on, and my eyes are kind of looking at it. And they're previewing the biggest game of the night. And it occurred to me the biggest game of the night in baseball last night was the Texas Rangers playing the Houston Astros. Now, I know baseball is a regional sport. It's not national, not like football. Football, you're going to watch the Oakland Raiders play the Arizona Cardinals, even if you live on the East Coast and you're a Giant fan. Why? Because you're betting it. Whether you're betting the game, you've got fantasy players. But in football, you care about all the games, all the teams. Baseball, it's not like that. You're in New York, you care about the Mets and Yankees. You're in Miami, you care about the Marlins. It's not a national game. Yet Texas-Houston was all the rave last night, and the Rangers won. Now, when the Rangers got Cole Hamels around the trade deadline, everybody said, wait till next year. Next year, they're going to have a 1-2 punch of Cole Hamels and Hugh Darvish. Good luck beating that. No one thought this year was already next year because don't look now, but with the win last night, the Rangers are in first.
Yeah, this is insane. I mean, this is like the Mets collapse 6 years ago. This is unreal. And Dallas Keuchel is in line to pitch the Sunday to end the season.
Yeah.
So he will not be available for the wild card game.
One-game playoff, right, if in
if
fact
they happen
need
to drop that, which is huge.
Well, they've got Scott Kazmir. Not a bad guy to go.
I know, but
you want Keuchel.
Keuchel has been the AL Player of the Month 4 times this season.
Right. That's the guy you want.
He's the guy you want, but I that's insane. That's crazy to even think about. The Rangers are in first place.
Did anybody back in March think that early September, we'd be talking about the Texas Rangers and the Houston Astros as the biggest game in Major League Baseball on any given night. He did not get back to me, of course, because it's probably a stupid question. He's busy and got no time for me, which I understand. Although the girl who was on this program yesterday, who's on television right now alongside Chris Cuomo, New Day on CNN, she couldn't tweet me enough. Allison Camarota, she's all over me.
She's great.
She's all over me.
She's a show favorite now.
Yes, she is. John Berman is the host, along with Christina Romans, of Early Start, which is on CNN from like 4 to 6 a.m. before New Day with Chris Cuomo and Allison. He also hosts a show at 11 a.m. at this hour, and he's been filling in all summer long for Jake Tapper, Anderson Cooper, all those guys. And I sent him a tweet. I said, listen, your teammate Allison came on today and killed it. Are you ready? And it took him 2 minutes to get back and say what time. So coming up live, he just got off the air himself, off TV himself, in about 10 minutes from CNN, host of not one but two shows each and every morning, John Berman will join us coming up at 6:30. This guy, you know, has become a favorite of mine. He's been on the show twice already. I met him when I was a guest of Sean Hannity up in New York. It was me, it was your friend Tamara Holder, and it was this guy, Ron Christie. Christie, of course, worked for John Kasich, worked for Dick Cheney, worked for President Bush. He has been in the White House about 1,000 times, in the Oval Office about 1,000 times. He still teaches at both Harvard and Georgetown. He's an amazing guy, and Ron Christie will join us to break down the debate coming up at 7:30. Then we'll talk to the Clinton campaign guy, whether it's Bill or Hillary, and that's Lonnie Davis coming up at 8. Jen Rubin from the Washington Post will also break down tonight's debate coming up at 8:45. We'll do some college football today, too. This is now, what, week three we're going into?
Yep, week three.
Any big games? I'll have to take a look at the docket. Who's number one right now? I should know this. I guess it's still Ohio State.
Yeah, it's got to be.
Big week one. Alabama has been very impressive so far in the early going. Michigan State had that big win over Oregon last week. So we'll talk college football with the star of ESPN Game Day, Lee Corso. Not so fast. Stopping by at 9 o'clock. And then a great baseball conversation coming up with Tim McCarver. And that, of course, is at 9:30. Nobody better. I mean, is there anybody better to talk all-time baseball, postseason baseball? Nobody's done more World Series than Tim McCarver. So you got John Berman, CNN, coming up at 6:30. Ron Christie coming up at 7:30. Lonnie Davis coming up at 8. Jen Rubin, Washington Post, 8:45. Lee Corso, ESPN, coming up at 9. And the all-time great Tim McCarver talking baseball at 9:30. And then today is the return of the Uncensored show. We did one last Thursday. It did very, very, very well. And, of course, Friday I had to go to New York to see my dad, so we did not do one on Friday. I got back yesterday. We did not do one yesterday. We will be bring it back today. And we've got a great guest stopping by the Uncensored show today, and that is my main man, 25 years as the executive producer of the I Miss in the Morning show, and my partner on WABC in New York a couple of weeks ago, Bernard McGurk, will be on the Uncensored show to break down the debate and curse. And that'll be fun.
Sounds good.
I said, Bernard, you can come on the last 20 minutes of the actual radio show today, which he really can't now because of Tim McCarver. Or we're now doing an Uncensored podcast after the show where you can say anything and curse. And he's like, I'm coming on that. So we've got John Berman, Ron Christie, Lonnie Davis, Jen Rubin, Lee Corso, and Tim McCarver on the radio show, and then Bernard McGurk on the podcast. It's going to be an amazing day. You know the number, as always, 888-640-9385, 888-640-9385. We'll take a short break. Our first guest stopping by in about 8 minutes, fresh off his television show on CNN, John Berman talks debate CNN right after this.
Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
When it comes to foreign policy, there is nobody of the 17 candidates better than Lindsey Graham.
Mr. Trump's solution to destroy ISIL is for us to go to take oil from Iraq and Syria and pay our wounded warriors with it. That is the most absurd way in the world to destroy ISIL.
What do you believe? What is your way the best to destroy ISIL?
You got
to
have a ground zone that you can't do it from the air, Sid, and we don't have the right configuration on the ground in Iraq. Obama has 3,500 troops. I would add 10,000. Nobody seems to understand what you got to do to destroy ISIL.
Because they're scared, Lindsey, because, look, nothing...
They're scared to tell people something
right.
They don't want to hear.
Right, nothing you need my approval. See, I agree with you.
Well, don't vote for me. Don't vote for me if you don't want somebody to destroy ISIL.
You know,
I intend to destroy these bastards.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
The stage is almost set for the second GOP debate. 3 days from today, 15 candidates facing off at the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library. And once again, Donald Trump will literally be center stage. And Trump's continuing rise in the polls means this debate could be even more contentious than the first, as all of the other GOP hopefuls focus their attacks on Trump and vie for their own breakout moments. So how do you handle all these fired-up candidates and then a wild card like Donald Trump? Let's ask the man who's about to do it, CNN anchor Jake Tapper, who's at the debate site in Simi Valley, California. Jake, thanks so much for being here this morning.
Of course. Good to see you, Brian.
Have you been watching, like, game tapes, so to speak? How do you prepare to moderate these debates?
Look, the challenge is going to be considerable, given the fact that you have 11 candidates on the stage for the main debate, and they all want to talk, and they all want to make their points. We're just going to try to enforce the rules. A minute when you're called on, 30 seconds to respond if your name has been mentioned or you've been attacked. And I'm just going to do the best I can. I don't know if bringing out a whip and a lion tamer's chair would help, but we're just going to try to enforce the rules and ask the questions and see what happens.
Is one of the goals for you on Wednesday to spur more actual debating? And what I mean by that was one of the most interesting moments in the Fox debate last month is when Chris Christie and Rand Paul, side by side, actually talked to each other and debated each other.
You and I are of like minds on that. I completely agree. That was my favorite moment from the debate. And when I saw that, I talked to our boss, Jeff Zucker, and I said that was my favorite part of the Fox debate. There were a lot of great moments, but that was my favorite one because it was actually two guys passionately debating an important issue. Let's have as many of those as possible. So yes, what the team and I have been doing is trying to craft questions that in most cases pit candidates against the other specific candidates on the stage on issues where they disagree, whether it's policy or politics or leadership. Let's actually have them discuss and debate. I'm going to be trying. Now, look, they're going to want to be talking to the camera. They're going to want to be getting out their talking points. But I'm going to try, attempt to get them to address each other and actually debate.
In a way, haven't seen you in a while. How've you been? Have you changed your style and do you think that we've grown up differently? Don't seem the same. Seems you've lost your feel for me. So let's leave it alone, 'cause we can't see eye to eye. There ain't no good guy, there ain't no bad guy. There's only you and me, and we just disagree.
My good buddy Lindsey Graham, who was on the show for the second time last Friday, and then that was Brian Stelter and Jake Tapper from CNN. Of course, the big debate tonight from Simi Valley, California, the Reagan Library on CNN, which has become my favorite station. I say that all the time. I love Chris Cuomo. I love Allison. I watch Anderson Cooper. I watch Jake. I watch Wolf. I watch Don. I watch them all. One of my favorite guys at CNN is a man that hosts the Early Start show right before Chris Cuomo. And then he's back again for At This Hour at 11 o'clock. He's also filled in a lot with Jake Tapper, Anderson Cooper, all these guys this summer. Making his second appearance on our program, a guy I like very, very much, is John Berman. John, good morning, pal. How are you?
That's a great intro. I'm great now.
All that is true. I didn't lie. You actually host not one but two television shows before noon each and every day, and you're like the number one guy off the bench.
Yeah, not bad, right? Not bad.
Not a bad gig if you can get it. And I put a lot of pressure on you yesterday because your teammate there, Allison, who's on with Chris Cuomo every morning, made her debut on this show yesterday, and she kicked some major, major ass. She was great, and all I had to do was tweet you that. Next thing I know, John Berman is back on the show.
You know, it's not a competition, but I'm winning. That's all I can say. You know, I take it very seriously.
Well, what about your role in this debate? We know that Jake is going to host it. Allison is going to be, I guess, back in the green room interviewing candidates as they come off the stage. Do you have any role in tonight's debate?
Tonight itself, once the debate starts, not so much. I've been out here since Sunday. We've been doing various shows since Sunday. I've actually been filling in for Jake while he's been getting ready for the debate on his show. But I've been out here. I talked to Ben Carson 2 days ago, interviewed Rand Paul yesterday. I'm on TV a whole bunch leading up until the debate tonight. And then once the debate starts, I have two rules. One is that I'm the guy who's going to be the lead reporter tomorrow morning on all of our news shows, you know, wrapping the debate, saying, this is what happened. Here's all the best sound. And I'll also be involved in the fact-checking of the debate, which is something I've done at CNN since 2012. We watch the debates and we try to figure out how much truth or lack thereof there is in some of the claims the candidates are making.
Well, that's important. Let's not forget that everybody's favorite moment from the first debate, and your buddy that Tapper just mentioned it, was the Rand Paul, Chris Christie back and forth. And there was some argument as to whether or not Chris Christie gave the right timeline as to when George Bush put him in a certain position. He said it was the day before September the 11th. I guess it turned out it was about 3 months after. So it's stuff like that, John, that really puts you on the spot.
Yeah, stuff like that. You know, stuff like Donald Trump saying, I've given money to all you guys, when in fact he's given money to some, but not all. You try to pick your spots and figure out what facts really matter, when people misspeak, you know, what's relevant to the discussion. You know, and sometimes, you know, debate isn't as much about facts as you might think. It's about various proposals and weighing the proposals and the presentation. So you just don't know until you see it.
I'll tell you what, my fear is that people don't care. Donald Trump can say, you all, and it's only two people. See, Donald Trump has had this amazing success based on very little substance. We all know that. That's a fact. Doesn't matter. You can build a wall here, build a wall there. People like the fact that he's brash, he's arrogant, he's got money, he doesn't care, and he speaks to a very angry America, which, by the way, I'm one of those guys, John Berman. So all that fact stuff, I think, works for the other 10 people. I think with Donald Trump, it doesn't matter.
I don't want you to be angry, Sid.
I'm pissed.
You know, not at this hour. No, you know, the interesting thing about Donald Trump, and I've been talking to a lot of Republican insiders the last few days who've been behind closed doors at focus groups, and people look at Donald Trump, and they may see bluster, they may see big speeches, they may see all the boasting, but he very cleverly touches on almost all the issues that are of the biggest concern, particularly to the Republican electorate right now. You know, China's killing us.
Nice.
You know, well, these Republican strategists tell me there's real concern about China in losing jobs overseas. There's real concern about immigration. Look, there will be debate now. There'll be debate in the general election whether or not Trump's ideas about immigration, you know, are the right ones. But these are concerns that people have in on. Listen carefully to his economic ideas, because they're not traditionally Republican, but they may be where the Republican voters actually are in some cases, not the establishment. You know, tax the hedge fund guy. That's not something you would have heard Mitt Romney say, but that's something that you do see among the voting population. So, no, not 45-point policy papers from Trump, but he's touching on the issues that matter to voters.
We want to see those tonight. You spoke specifically about the economy. The hedge fund guys are exactly right. And this brings us to, I think, what most people want to see tonight. Not necessarily Chris Christie and Rand Paul, closer to the bottom 10 than the top 10, but two folks right there at the very top, Donald Trump and Carly Fiorina. I think most of America watching this tonight would love to see those two go head-to-head on exactly that, the economy.
Yeah, sure. Instead of on Carly Fiorina's face, which is what Donald Trump brought up, you know, in that interview to Rolling Stone. Look, you know, you have two people who run companies, Donald Trump and Carly Fiorina. It'd be very interesting to see what they have to say. It's maybe a tough discussion. Maybe Carly Fiorina would prefer the discussion be about her face, though, as far as Donald Trump is concerned, because Trump's going to go after her hard on her role at Hewlett-Packard, on her time at the top there, and say that this thing she's running on, being a successful business person, that she wasn't successful at all. That's something Barbara Boxer did when Carly Fiorina ran for Senate in California. So that'll be interesting.
John Berman, of course, CNN, and he'll be at the debate tonight. He's been in California for days filling in for Jake Tapper while Jake gets ready to moderate tonight's debate. You said, John, that you spoke to guys like Rand Paul, Ben Carson the last couple of days on TV leading up to tonight. Anybody strike you that was face-to-face, not television? You interviewed these guys personally. That was really present?
It was remote. Full disclosure, it was remote. Ben Carson was in D.C. I talked to remote, and Rand Paul not in person, but I met a lot of these guys.
Fair enough. Anybody that really strikes you as presidential, somebody you really, really, really like that may or may not be getting the pub they deserve?
It's an interesting question. I'm going to take an easy road out there to an extent, but I won't take a fully easy road out. I think anyone who gets to this level, anyone who throws their hat in the ring to run for president needs to be commended. It takes a certain amount of bravery and courage to put yourself
you know
what
you're doing,
like
John.
This.
You know, it's funny because just to make a sports analogy, because obviously I do sports too, and you're a big sports fan. You may notice that in an NBA game, for example, when that 12th guy gets off the bench, he gets a very sarcastic applause from the crowd, and people tend to love that guy. And what the folks don't understand is that guy, that 12th guy off the bench, he will kill anybody else in the country who fancies himself as a good basketball player. That guy is actually a great basketball player. You're saying the same thing about these people tonight.
That's right. And, you know, I've had great discussions with George Pataki and Bobby Jindal, not to mention Rick Santorum. Look, one of my big regrets in political coverage, I've been a reporter for years. I interviewed Rick Santorum 4 years ago in November, and all my questions to him were like, you got no chance, pal. Why are you still in this? Why don't you just drop out? Well, sure enough, you know, a month and a half later, he goes and wins Iowa. He practically gets the Republican nomination. And what I learned then, you know, is it's not for me to say who's going to win and not win. Don't care so much about the polls. Listen to what they're saying. Watch what they're doing. You ask me who's the most presidential. I'm not going to – that's something that the voters should decide. I shouldn't be saying that. I think all of them have impressive resumes. It's an incredibly, incredibly deep field. John Kasich's the governor of Ohio. Yeah. Ohio's a big state. Rick Perry dropped out. That guy was governor of Texas for 165 years. George Pataki, three-term governor of New York, and he's not polling above 1%. These are people who have done very big jobs. Yeah. Many of them left these big jobs or are in these big jobs with very high, you know, high approval rating, and they're all losing to a guy who hosted a reality show.
Not just him. I mean, you've got Carly Fiorina, not a politician. Ben Carson, not a politician. All enjoying success. And Rick Santorum is the most interesting of all, John, because, like you said, he won Iowa. He was in second place for the GOP just 4 years ago. And I hate to call it a relegation, but he has been relegated to the kiddie table, the happy hour table, whatever you want to call it. It's got to be really frustrating for him.
You know, I will say, first of all, I approve your use of the word relegation. I think that the British English soccer rules need to be applied so many different places in life, and this happens to be one of them. I think Rick Santorum is an interesting place in this campaign right now, and to an extent, Bobby Jindal also. There are people tonight in both debates who I think, if they do not perform well tonight and over the next week or so, they may be done. I mean, you know, the stakes are very high for Jeb Bush right now. He can't not do well for much longer before his donors are going to get nervous. But there are other people who can last for a long time where they are right now because it doesn't cost much to be Rick Santorum in this race. Lindsey Graham, your friend Lindsey Graham, doesn't cost anything to be Lindsey Graham in this race. You know, he drives around in a rental car with one dude all over the country and, you know, and send troops to Iraq.
Right.
But he can do that for a long time. And he can be there in January if the race gets shuffled up. And they may have a chance later from now. There are people for whom the expectations were so high. Chris Christie, Jeb Bush, Scott Walker, another one. They may not have the time that Rick Santorum has. I know that sounds strange when Rick Santorum is polling, you know, at an asterisk level right now. But he may have a longer time horizon than some of these guys ahead of him.
You think any of these four guys, we saw Cali, two more will let you run, John, excellent job and great to have you this morning. We saw Carly Fiorina make the jump from one table to the next. Any of these four guys, Governor Pataki out of New York, Santorum out of Pennsylvania, Jindal out of Louisiana, and my friend Lindsey out of South Carolina, any one of these four guys you think has a legitimate opportunity that by the time October 28th rolls along, they've got a shot to get to the next level? We talk about guys that may be done after tonight. What about guys who have a chance to promote themselves?
You know, I think look at Bobby Jindal. He's been out putting these videos about Donald Trump out the last several days. He wants it the most. You get the sense that he's the type of guy who would crawl through broken glass to get to that big
stage. And are you saying that because he has publicly, like you said, the video's been attacking? He's called. He's actually name-calling at this point Donald Trump. Do you think that is the best way for these guys to get noticed?
I think it's a way to get noticed on that debate stage and leading up to this debate. And it's not just because he's Donald Trump. I mean, anytime there's a front runner, and there always is a front runner, going after the front runner, trying to engage that person is what gets you in the headlines. I mean, we cover front runners more, people who are in front more, because they get the most support in what they say, you know, it is most interesting. So it's a good way to get your name out there. And his aggressiveness over the last few days, I think, is indicative of what he wants to make of this moment. So I think he could be on the rise, and I think it's possible that there are people on that main stage who are slipping. You know, Scott Walker, he needs something big tonight.
Yeah.
You know, you've heard, if you've been reading the articles, you've been talking to people. I mean, you know, his supporters are like, hey, wait a second, what's going on here? You were supposed to win Iowa. It's not what you think. I should tell you, I'd be remiss if I did not mention right now where I'm standing. I am underneath the debate stage.
Awesome.
I am underneath the 707 that Ronald Reagan used as Air Force One.
Awesome.
It's just a stunning set.
God, I'm so jealous, John. I got to be honest with you. but at least you're a good guy, and I like you, so good for you. I think you kind of intimated it earlier. Is it fair to say then, you talk about guys like Scott Walker need a good showing. Marco Rubio could use a good showing. He was so good the first debate and made so much noise. It would be in his best interest to do it again. But is it fair to say that the most pressure tonight is on Jeb Bush?
Yes. I mean, yes, I absolutely think that Jeb Bush, who's got that $100 million war chest in his super PAC, has got the Bush name. He's, you know, he locked up a lot of establishment support. They're nervous. These supporters, these big money people, are nervous right now, and they want to see something from him. It doesn't need to be a knockout blow. He doesn't need to, you know, he doesn't need to floor Donald Trump. He doesn't need to turn this whole race on its edge. But he needs to show his supporters that he understands and has the passion to, you know, to do what it takes to win and to get in the center of this discussion. Marco Rubio is an interesting case. I happen to think, it's my opinion, that he's another one of these guys who's content to take a step back, let the fight play out, and to be here in January. You know, he had a good performance in the first debate, like you said, but he hasn't been part of the tit-for-tat argument with Donald Trump or anyone else for that matter.
Yep.
I mean, Marco Rubio is catching footballs in videos right now. He's perfectly happy to do that while these other people fight, because I think he feels, you know, he's not running for re-election in the Senate. He's gonna be here for a long time.
He actually made the point just 3 days after the first debate with my buddy Chuck Todd on Meet the Press that he's not going after Donald Trump, that if he did that every single day, he'd have no time for his own campaign. So on the way out, John, look, I go to Super Bowls, all these major events, and but as I'm getting older and doing this longer and longer, I admit that news and politics is starting to really creep up on me, and it maybe even at this point has exceeded everything I want to do in sports. But the question for you is, you've done all that as well. You cover every major story, been on television a long time. Where you are right now, you just kind of set this scene. Sounds really cool. Is this tonight, because it's Trump, it's getting so much attention, it has just become for you kind of the Super Bowl of events, the second debate tonight?
Yeah, well, you know, at CNN, that's what we're calling it. We're calling this the Super Bowl of politics. It's really exciting. I mean, we saw the interest in the first debate. I think the interest level is just as high right now, and it matters. I mean, I love sports myself. I'm a huge Patriots fan, which I'm happy to admit in front of anyone, even in Florida.
Yeah. By the way, they're going to get romped by the Buffalo Bills on Sunday, but they do win Super Bowl, so I can't argue with you.
Well, why do you got to say that? Why do you got to say that? but as much as I love Tom Brady and the Patriots, you know, it's a football game. This has all the excitement, and it really matters. I mean, you're talking about, you know, the most important job, I think, in the world, becoming president of the United States. So what these people say, it counts. And it's not just what they say, it's how they say it. You want to watch their performance, and it's not just about theatrics, but it's, you know, it's about the ability to communicate, because being a president is about communication. So I just think it's fascinating at every level.
You can catch him every single morning alongside our good friend Christine Romans on Early Start, also at this hour with Kate at 11, and has done a really, really terrific job filling in for everybody from Jake Tapper to Anderson Cooper all summer long. And that is my friend John Berman. John, this was not good. It was great. I appreciate you taking time out this morning on this busy, busy day, and I really hope you keep coming back, because I really am a big fan of yours. Thank you so much.
Thanks, and great to talk to you.
Excellent job, John Berman over at CNN. And a very likable guy, too. Smart guy, great on television, obviously knows his stuff, and very likable as well. Again, catch him coming up at 11 at this hour, and Early Start each and every morning before, of course, Chris Cuomo and Allison every morning on CNN. 888-640-9385. We'll take a short break. We're back on a very busy Sid Rosenberg show. Still to come, Ron Christie, Lanny Davis, Jen Rubin from The Washington Post, Lee Corso, ESPN, and Tim McCarver, all stopping by today. We'll come back with more right after this. We'll be right back.
so don't forget it. It's just a silly phase I'm going through. And just because I call you up, don't get me wrong, don't think you got it made. I'm not in love, no, no.
Five on your Wednesday morning, back here on the Sid Rosenberg Show. That was just John Berman from CNN. Once again, he hosts Early Start before Chris Cuomo and Allison alongside Christine Romans at 4 a.m., I think, every morning. Then he does the At This Hour show at 11 a.m. alongside Kate Baldan. He's filled in all summer for Anderson Cooper and Jake Tapper and the whole crew, and he was very, very good. And that is the first of six guests we'll have on today. My good friend Ron Christie, who worked alongside John Kasich in Ohio for 8 years, also worked at the White House for Dick Cheney and George Bush. He'll join us at 7:30. Mr. Clinton campaign himself for 30 years in and around Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton each and every day. Seth Davis's father, Lanny Davis, will be here at 8. Jen Rubin from the Washington Post will preview tonight's debate coming up at 8:45. We'll do college football with one of the mainstays, the stars of ESPN Game Day, maybe the star, Lee Corso. Not so fast, coming up at 9:05. And we'll do Tim McCarver, the great baseball player and analyst, Tim McCarver, coming up at 9:30. The Yankees lost last night, but so did Toronto. They remain three back. Mets lost. Washington won. Met lead has been reduced to a very comfortable 8.5. And the Texas Rangers beat the Houston Astros last night. So Texas is now in first place atop the AL West. That has been an amazing race. Our intern, Ricky Balupe, just telling me that if you go to SidRosenberg.net today, SidRosenberg.net is the official website of this fine program, and you can see naked pictures of Chris West there. Thanks for providing those, Chris. Thank you. That's very nice of you.
You know, I try to contribute as much as I can.
For a fat guy, you've got a pretty big penis, just so you know.
That's how it works.
Mm-hmm. SidRosenberg.net, you have Sid's store there, too. You can buy any one of our great Sid T-shirts, the Giant T-shirt, the Met T-shirt, the, of course, very popular Red Citizen T-shirt. Now, the best of all, the light blue Kiss America or Kiss My Ass Sid Rosenberg Show T-shirt, all available on the Sid's store on SidRosenberg.net. We've also got pictures of me with some famous people, celebrities wearing all of our T-shirts, bios from the whole crew, including Eric Langell, who's on vacation right now. And we've got audio there, too. Ricky Balufe does that. And he's telling me that both Allison Camerata, who was great yesterday, CNN on this program, her interview, and Billy Baldwin, both those interviews are on the front page right now at Sid Rosenberg. And I know, Chris West, that you loved the Billy Baldwin conversation yesterday.
Yesterday, yeah. But Billy Baldwin was just one of those really cool hangout kind of guys. It's sad, like you said, he was doing the book. He's doing the tour for the movie that he's doing on
TV show.
TV show.
Yeah, so we had to get to that eventually. But he started off talking about the Yankees and Massapequa, Long Island, and the Baldinger brothers. And you can tell very early on there was a nice relationship there with me and Billy.
Oh, very clearly.
And then you were just breaking my balls about my enthusiasm level for my conversation moments ago with John Berman.
Well, you made the comment that you're getting to the point where politics is... you are there.
Yeah.
It's not you're getting to. You are there. You are literally shaking, smiling ear to ear, giddy as a schoolboy, talking, that whole segment, just like you wanted to be in the debate. You want to be a moderator.
So badly. At least be there at the Ronald Reagan Library in California this morning. I mean, I've done a ton of Super Bowls now, over 10. I'll be in San Francisco for the 50-year anniversary of the Super Bowl this year. I've done World Series. I've never done an NBA Finals. I have done a bunch of Final Fours. I've done the Major League Baseball All-Star Games. I've done huge golf events, the U.S. Open in San Francisco, the PGA in Sahali, Washington. I've done every major tennis event outside of Wimbledon. I've done everything. And I will tell you that one of these debates or an inauguration for the president, one of those is what's missing. That's on the effort list, bucket list, the effort list. So, yes, I was a bit jealous, John Berman, by the airplane You ever seen it? You've seen that before, the Reagan Library. They've got a big airplane, and he was right there this morning talking to us because he was off the air at 6, of course. He goes back on the air at 11, and he was kind enough to stick around and do the interview, and it was a very good interview with that. So don't forget, coming up later on tonight on CNN, you've got at 6 o'clock, you've got the kiddies table, only 4 tonight. That should make for a very good debate, actually. Only 4 people: out of New York, Governor Pataki; out of Pennsylvania, Rick Santorum; out of Louisiana, Bobby Jindal; and out of South Carolina, my friend Lindsey Graham. And then the 11, the big 11, come your way at 8 o'clock tonight, a 3-hour debate on CNN with Donald Trump, Carly Fiorina, Ben Carson, Jeb Bush, Scott Walker, Chris Christie, Rand Paul, Ted Cruz, Mike Huckabee, John Kasich, and Marco Rubio. 888-640-9385. That's the number. We'll take some phone calls next segment because, like I said, once 7:30 rolls along, we've got great guests, huge name guests from news and politics and college football and baseball and NFL, all that stuff. So if you want to get in, I recommend you get in next. We'll take a short break. The 7 o'clock hour is right around the corner.